الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وخاتم النبيين أبي القاسم المصطفى.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين. أما بعد، respected brothers and sisters, after a long break, we are alhamdulillah today continuing our discussion on Islamic theology. Due to this long break, naturally, I think there are certain things which we discussed and explained in detail. A little bit maybe forgotten or so. Quickly to connect our discussions of today to our previous discussions, I would like to take you just one or two steps back in our discussions. In other words, topics which we have already addressed, but I would like to just list them. Basically, we are in chapter of Tawheed, or our belief in monotheism, or our belief in unity. And this belief and this faith has various aspects to be discussed, various angles to be addressed, and also as a result, number of questions and subsequent discussions appear which we need to also speak about them and respond to them. If I want to quickly take you back to Tawheed, we say there are different types of Tawheed or different understandings of Tawheed. We all as Muslims believe in Tawheed, which means that there is only one God, one Creator. But it's not that simple. There are, as I said, various aspects to look at this concept of oneness or unity. The first type of Tawheed we discussed was Tawheed of essence or negation of plurality. Ta'addud, in other words, when we say Allah is one, it's not a numerical one. It's not a numerical one. We are saying there is no plurality. Not there is a plural and he does not have a plural. No, there is no plurality. There is no possibility to imagine for Allah multiplicity. Anyway, we discussed it in detail. With arguments, we will not go there. Second type of Tawheed we discussed was negation of composition, tarkib. You know, when we say negation of plurality, it means to imagine one God next to another God. And negation of composition means that to imagine inside God particles and parts. We also discussed in detail with arguments and reasoning impossible. And the third was negation of attributes, Tawheed of Sifat, where we said that when we attribute our Lord Almighty Allah, we do not attribute the way we attribute ourselves or any other thing, because our attributes are extra to our essence, are additional to our essence. While in the case of Allah, attributes of Allah, Allah Himself, itself. And therefore, attribution in the sense we understand normally, not possible in case of Allah, not imaginable in case of Almighty Allah, Wajib Wujud. So this was another very important discussion. We have it in detail also. The fourth Tawheed is unity of action. And if you remember, now little I need to explain once again, unity of action means in any action, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is actor. He does not need anyone to help, anyone to support, or anyone to complete his job, in other words. No, he himself is sufficient to act. More technically talking, illa dhamma, or complete cause. Remember, we discussed, and I don't want to repeat, but it's technical, therefore I need to little bit explore that illa dhamma, or complete cause, is a cause which is impossible to be separated from effect. If it is there, effect is there. It's not waiting. No more waiting period. No more hanging. No more dependence. Kun fayakun. Be and it is there. There is no distance. There is no distance between illat dhamma or complete cause and effect. Allah is illat dhamma or complete cause in this sense, that in any action, in any phenomena, Allah does not need anything else. Nothing. What's at this condition? Explain. His will is equal to his action, basically. Anyway, those discussions we have already last time. Next one, or the fifth of Tawheed, is unity of effectuality. Ta'thir, in effect. What does it mean? That, look, therefore I said we need to speak. Tawheed of af'al, or Tawheed of action, unity of action, and unity of effectuality are a little bit close, but very delicate difference. And therefore, I would like you to understand it quickly today. Maybe last time, I don't know how much it was clear. Tawheed of actions means, as I just explained, he alone himself is complete cause, does not need anybody, does not need help, does not need support, nothing is waiting, happiness, right there. Unity of effectuality is that whatever in this world takes place, whatever in this world phenomena, if I'm using the word phenomena right, phenomena, any phenomena in this world is affected by him. He is the effective. There is no effective other than him. That's unity. He is the effective. He is only effective. If anything takes place, any phenomena on any level takes place, he is the one who is only and only effective. Okay? These two things please remember. Let's move. What is the result? Unity of action. Unity of action or negation of multiple actors or helpers in an action. We discussed it already. We will not repeat. You have heard of posture samadhi. We have quite a bit of detail in this record and I don't need to repeat. That results that only he deserves to be worshipped. I need to really move, otherwise beautiful discussion. Shashamani got to this. So you people have listened, if they didn't, please listen. Interesting, small discussion, but nice discussion. When we believe that only he is cause, complete cause, he is the only one who desires to be above than worship. Unity of effectuality is negation of effectiveness of anyone other than Allah. No one is effective, only he. In other words, simple words, he is the only one who can do. No one else can do nothing. He is the one who only can do. And what does it mean? What's the result of that? Only he can be trusted. Only he can be trusted. And only he can have, or he can be requested for help. Because he only is the one who has effect. And as Ayatollah Husna says, this is what it is mentioned in this particular verse of Holy Quran, which says, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. This is tawheed of action and tawheed of effectuality. It is you we worship and it is you we ask for help. Okay. So this is all our discussions of last week. Then, if you remember last week, we had a very interesting discussion on that point. As a footnote, basically, that if he is only, can have Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'in, then what is the meaning of tawassul? And what is the meaning of seeking help from anyone other than Allah? I will not repeat that discussion also in detail. Had it, alhamdulillah, question and answer was there, and I will not repeat. Go back to those notes if you want to. It's a very important and interesting discussion. Let's move to the next, which is today's discussion. And that is a result of unity of effectuality. If you say that only Allah is effective and no one else, there is a very serious question raises, and that's the question of free will or compulsion, or determinism, other word used to that chapter. How? Let me explain to you the problem itself. The problem is this, that based upon this tawheed, that only effective is Allah, and only actor is Allah, la mu'assara illallah, then who are we? Nothing. Nothing. So we cannot do anything. Everything Allah does. We cannot produce anything. We cannot do anything. Everything is in the hand of Allah. So, in other words, is our hands are tied and we are compelled and our destiny is determined. Okay, that's a different question, but anyway, we are already sitting in this situation where we have no say over our actions. So there is this discussion which is called Jabr and Ikhtiyar, free will or compulsion. As a result of this tawheed or unity of effectuality. You have, inshallah, I hope, think that have listened to the lectures of Sheikh Shomani and also read the text. So I will not go that much into details, but let me just give you a little bit of explanation for the continuation of our discussion. Basically, in response to this question, there are two approaches, or there are two, you know, trends of thinking which appeared in the history, in the history of the theology of Islam. One was known as Ash'arites, and the other approach was known as Mu'tazilites. I'm not saying there are no other approaches, no. Formally, these two approaches are the major approaches. There were, of course, people who, even before them, they understood differently or whatever, but I'm referring to, you know, traditionally speaking, two major, two main approaches in the mainstream Muslim society. Ash'arites, who are basically historically talking, they came in existence after Mu'tazilites, of course. Abu Musa Ash'ari, Abu Hassan Ash'ari, was a student of Mu'tazilite in Basra, and then he, you know, that's also another interesting discussion. Somehow Iraq, which is center of all these discussions, Basra, Baghdad, both sides, Ash'arites and Mu'tazilites. Giants of those both schools born in Iraq, died in Iraq, and from there they expanded. And Ash'arites approach is why I put it first, while historically they were after Mu'tazilites. The reason is this, that they are the one who finally won the war and they became the dominant, controlling or predominantly Muslims followed them. They became the aqeedah of majority. Until today, probably, I don't know how many, 400 million or something, people follow Ash'ari school. In loose terms, by the way, but I must be fair. When I say they are Ash'arites, not necessarily exactly what the school of Ash'arite was in Star. No, developed, of course. In Ash'ari school itself, various opinions came up and different schools of thought developed and so on. But I just wanted to give you a bit of a background. These two schools have basically, you know, two issues which separated them. A couple of things, but mainly one school in understanding of Aqeedah, please with me, in understanding of our faith and belief or our opinion about God, depending on texts, nusus, ayat of Quran, hadith of the Prophet, and because they were Sunni, so even aqeedah of what they call it Sahaba, and aqeedah of Tabi'in, and aqeedah of Tabi' Tabi'in, which they call it Salaf al-Saleh, or the pious ancestors. They very much, of course, dependent on this source in understanding of our opinion about God and Allah, including this particular issue which we are discussing, issue of compulsion, determinism, or free will. While Mu'tazilites were a group of people whose emphasis was not so much on text, but rather on aql, rationality, and reason. And therefore, these discussions go very deep down, brother. This whole course itself, if you want to discuss this issue, the role of aql and rationality, basically, that itself is a very real discussion. Ash'arites used to think like that, that aql, or in human intellect, independently, mustaqillan, cannot distinguish good and bad, cannot define what is good and what is bad. It requires help of Quran and Hadith to understand what is good and what is bad. While Mu'tazilites believed that no aql, intellect, independently can understand what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is bad. Ash'arites, at least on the apparent part or the, you know, outside, what you call it, face value, they greatly emphasized on Tawheed, oneness, with all these meanings which I gave you already, four or five different meanings I gave you. They greatly emphasized on Tawheed. Okay? As Mu'tazilites, more emphasized on Tanzih, they insisted on Tawheed, they insisted on Tanzih. What is Tawheed? I explained. What is Tanzih? Tanzih means remove any defect from God. You know, emphasis of Asharaitmas on Tawheed and emphasis of Mu'tazilaitmas that God cannot be defective. God cannot have any shortcoming. God cannot have any defect. Very, very interesting incident history has recorded in this regard. When they used to visit each other, they used to pinch, you know, they used to taunt each other with these things. Used to walk in and there's a Mu'tazilite sitting, the person with Asharite used to praise due to Allah Almighty Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, who created everything, and no one is the partner in his creation. And Mu'tazilite used to respond like that. All praise due to Allah, who never commits evil or does not create sharr and corruption and fasad. Can you do? Let me take you from another angle. Imam Musa Hasan alayhi salatu wasalam. Imam of Ahlul Bayt beautifully explained. He says that Ash'ara, Asharites, not he does not mention the name Asharite, but of course that school of thought, they basically took justice from Allah. Because they say everything Allah can do. Unlimited power of Allah. So Allah can do anything. So they took away justice of Allah, and Mu'tazilites took away Tawheed from Allah. And therefore, La Jabra Wala Tafweez Al Amru Bainal Amrain. We, school of Ahlul Bayt, do not believe in compulsion nor in the free will the way Mu'tazilites understood. But the matter is between two matters, which we will inshallah today with the help of Allah Almighty again, because He is the only effective. Inshallah, we'll try to explain to our brothers and sisters. Salawat
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
Brother, Nawshad, brother, Muhammad Nawshad. Posted something very interesting this morning on the theological group. And I would like to quickly, very quickly respond before we get into the technical discussion here. That brothers and sisters, without any doubt, there is a political aspect to these debates and discussions, there's absolutely no doubt about it. And I would like to recommend brothers to read a book by Ayatollah Mutahhari by the name of Man Is and His Destiny. Please read this book if you can. It's available online, but not complete. It's not such greatly translated the way I looked at this morning. But anyway, whatever it is, they're not bad. That's a very interesting book. You can read it. Anyway, yes, there is a political angle to this discussion. Probably this, because Asharites, of course, came much later in the form of a school of thought, but original discussion was always there. At least when I am saying, when I am saying two major approaches, Asharites and Mu'tazilites, please don't misunderstand. I am not saying they are the two people or they are the two schools who came up with this debate. No. Right in the time of the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then of course in the later period and era, These discussions were there.
And we will bring some of the examples.
No. It was always there, because as soon as a person looks at this tawheed of factuality, which is without any doubt part of the discussion of Quran, there's no doubt. I didn't get a chance to reach that point, but without any doubt, this discussion is there. Quran very clearly says, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ. You don't intend anything except what Allah intends. وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ. When you shoot the arrow, you did not. Allah shooted it, for example. And so on. So, naturally, this discussion is very old. Very, very old. Right from the start, this discussion came. That are we free, or everything Allah does, and we have no say over our actions. Look, let me just quickly hear that. Maybe I'm going to be your nice tonight today. One issue very important, let me tell you that Quran itself, you know, Quran itself has, of course, without any doubt, plenty of verses which apparently support Ash'arites. Few of them I just now read for you. You are nothing, everything is Allah. You can't do nothing except Allah. You don't intend except Allah. But let me tell you something. In equal or if not more in numbers, there are verses of the Quran which support Mu'tazilite opinion. We are free. So many verses which speak that everyone is responsible. لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانَ إِلَّا Masa, for insan, there is nothing but what he strives. No? If he cannot strive, then what does it mean? وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. Nobody will carry the burden of other. What does it mean? Or all the ayat which speak about punishment and reward, on what basis? So, there are indeed plenty of verses which apparently support Ash'arite opinion and plenty of verses which support not the likes of even of free will. From where we understand that insan is free, and there are verses which say, no, insan has no say, everything is in the hand of Allah. So, therefore, this conflict was always the apparent conflict. And people come to the Prophet or Ahlul Bayt or Imams or Sahaba or whatever, and they ask this question, what does it mean? And they have explained it, but okay, that's now a different discussion. Once again, Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad.
Anyway, brothers and sisters, quickly let me take you to the next point about the Ash'arites. So, why I am saying we are saying Ash'arites and Mu'tazilites? Because then the opinion became proper, formal, structured school. Therefore, I am saying, I am not. When saying Ash'arite means that particular school which came in existence after so many years. No, no, no. Ash'arites, I am referring that particular trend of thinking. Yeah, that's what I want to mean. Where man has no say over his own actions. Okay. Ash'arite thinking, few very important some point about Ash'arite thinking. Listen carefully. There is another very interesting and important. Ash'arites say only effective is Allah. Everything Allah does. So the question came up in our mind, brothers and sisters. Then what is the relationship between cause and effect? Now, the question comes, fire burns, or fire produces heat. So heat is effect, fire is cause. Now if you ask from an Ash'ari, somebody who has that Ash'ari thinking, what do you say, fire creates heat
பண்ணணும். எங்களோ எவரிதிங் இஸ் கிவன் பை காட்.
So then why we find always heat after fire or smoke after fire? If fire does not create heat, if fire does not create smoke, then why always when there is a fire there is heat, when there is a fire there is smoke? They said no.
You know how they answered this? Very interesting.
This kad jarala, it is Allah's habit that whenever there will be heat, fire, there will be heat also. Otherwise, heat has nothing to do with fire, fire has nothing to do with heat.
Sorry to say, but majority of people, aqeedah wise, live like that. Now, practically, they do something else, but they believe like that. So
it is, you can read, I am not saying aqeedah tahaviyya, that's what exactly what it says.
Adam is habit.
So if fire burns, it's habit of Allah that whenever there will be fire, it will burn. Otherwise, fire and burning got nothing to do with each other. So in all the phenomena, they denied the law of cause and effect, casuality. Which is really disaster, which is disaster, which is disaster. Anyway, not only I wish it would have stopped there, that everything which happens in the world, there's no cause and effect, everything Allah does it. It's just a habit of Allah that these things are next to each other. Okay. Not only that, they went further. And they said, now this is carefully, and this is exactly their words. And we're not exaggerating it. That af'alunnas makhluqullah. Means what? That actions of the people are also creation of Allah. In other words, whatever you do, you don't do nothing, it Allah does. And that is right, of course, in general. But in bracket, let me explain here very quickly. Yes, Ash'arites are Jabris, but certain level of Jabr. There are people who took this issue, like Jahmiyyah and Safan Jahm, literally like that, literally like that. Denial of free will from human beings to their actions, completely, nothing. Abul Hasan Ash'ari, founder of this Ash'arite school of thought, he tried to somehow fix it while keeping the principle. He said, yes, actions of Allah, actions of people are actions of Allah, actions of people are creation of Allah. And we have no say over it. But he introduced something new there next to it. And it's called, it's not discussed in our discussion, but I thought it's important to add here. It will be very unfair to give a complete picture. He added something next to it. He said, action belongs to Allah, yes. But there is something called kasb. Kasb. And that kasb is something which Allah gives to insan and creates in insan. And through to that kasb, person is rewarded or punished. In that kasb, there is a sort of a freedom there. He created. I give an example of a glass and water. Water is inside the glass. Does glass have anything to do with water, in creation of water? No. Are you with me?
week. Trying to make it simple, it's very difficult. It's one of the most difficult discussions in Islamic Aqeedah and theology, especially in Sunni school. Unfortunately, not very clear definitions there, what it meant. Therefore, if I remember correctly, 3-4 different explanations of kasb are given. What he meant by saying kasb. Kasb in Arabic means to achieve, to acquire. From that verse of Quran which says that on people is what they have acquired. Iman kasaba. And nafs will take whatever he eaten, kasb, whatever it acquires. This is water. Glance has no role in creation of water. But water is in glance. So action of human being has nothing to do with human being. But it is in that, what you call it, in that particular situation. And being just in that particular situation is sufficient for you to be punished or to be rewarded. So somehow they wanted to fix it. Somehow they wanted to address this problem. You know why? Because it's a big disaster. If you are saying that we have no say over our actions, if we have nothing, no control over ourselves, everything is in the hand of Allah. Third point which I have written here, elimination of responsibility. You know, responsibility, no responsibility. Finish. Understand. And also, of course, it compromises justice of Allah. Quran is so clear that Allah will punish kuffar and Allah will reward mu'mini. But how? Kafir has no power over his kufr. If he became kafir, because Allah made him kafir. If he became sinner, because Allah made him sinner. And mu'min, and muttaqi, and pious, if he became pious, if he became obedient of Allah, it's nothing to do with him, it's Allah who did it. And but then, to one Allah punishes, to other one Allah rewards. It's not justice. So there Allah is no justice, astaghfirullah. Now then, they were compelled to fix the definition of justice. Oh. What they say? They say that this is your definition of justice. That if Allah punishes someone for his kufr, while he has no right over his action, no say over his amal and action, Allah punishes him. And Allah rewards somebody who is mu'min while he has no say over his action of iman, then this is not justice according to you. No, our definition of justice is different. What is your definition? He said, whatever Allah does, that is just. So if Allah punishes a good man, that is justice. If Allah punishes a good man, it is justice. If Allah throws, for example, worst of the worst people in the world, it's fine. And if he rewards them, also fine. If Allah throws Trump in Jannah, it's good. This is justice. Netanyahu to paradise. This is exactly justice. If Allah doesn't, then it will be justice. Justice is exactly what Allah has. You don't have a criteria. Criteria of justice is Allah's action. It's again the same point which I made just before earlier. They denied independent role of akal. They said our akal cannot decide what is good, what is bad, what is just, what is not just. You are saying that why Allah punished this one and why Allah, whatever Allah does, that's right. Anyway, the compromise is to solve, which is of course not acceptable, but further another very serious problem with this trend of thinking of jabber and compulsion, determinism, is compromising the question of purpose of creation. My brother, if everything already like that, if Allah does everything, then what is the purpose of creation? Why Allah created us? Quran being very clear about it, it says that we created you for development, for test, for ittila, for evolution, for kamal, for takamul. It's no journey possible. If you have no say over your action, how you can become better or worse? To the purpose of creation, purpose of Sharia, purpose of Anbiya. Why Anbiya came? If you have no say over your own action, then if you cannot change, in other words, then does it make sense that I must come and tell you, don't do this and do this? Well, I can tell you only do this and don't do this. If you have any say over your action, if your hands are tied, if you are chained, you know, somebody has put all the chains around you, and then I am telling you, run, how I can run? If there are chains, then how I can say run? You understand what I'm saying? So what is the purpose of Sharia? What's the purpose of Anbiya? What's the purpose of divine books which came? Quran came for what? If it does not have any effect practically. So these are the problems of Ash'arites. And of course, Mu'tazilites, who gave complete freedom of will and choice for men. It's called Tafwid. You say, no! Based upon all these arguments which we have, they say, no! We are completely free. We can do whatever we want to do. Allah has no say. We can decide. We can decide. Based upon that, they say that rewards and punishments make sense. And it is also in coherence with divine justice and purpose of creation. All that is very good. But the problem Mu'tazilites have, that they have compromised Tawheed. In other words, they are saying that Allah's power is restricted and limited. Now that, if you remember very well, in our previous discussions and philosophical arguments we established, we say this is impossible to accept. Not based upon Quranic verses, no. Purely intellectual, philosophical arguments are against that. If you want to say that Allah has left us, it does not make sense. You remember very well discussions of wujud and wajib of wujud. Can you remember? These discussions are built up on those discussions, please. Wujud means our very existence. We exist because of Allah. And for a fraction of second, I'm saying to explain otherwise much more than that. If that link breaks, you will become nothing. You will become nothing. We have already established various philosophical, strong, concrete, conclusive arguments, purely logical, purely rational, purely reasonable, intellectual, that we depend on Allah. If you remember that whole Quran's theme, when we say that things or mojudat or existence are divided in three groups, that they are either wajibul wujud or mumkinul wujud or mumtaniul wujud. They are either compulsory existence or they are possible existence or they are impossible existence. We are possible existent, and for possible existence to come in existence, it requires wajibul wujud. And it does not require only in creation, but it continues. As much as long as you exist, you require link. I give, if you remember the example of powerhouse and electricity. To switch on this tube and this globe, you require power from a power source to switch it on. That's all. And then afterward you can switch it on? No. to keep it burning also you require that connection must be still there. As soon as power from the source of power will be disconnected, this tube will go off. It will be switch off. Are you with me or not? So we, not only in our original creation and hoodoos, depend on God or depend on Vaishnava, but regularly. Now, Maitreya is like by saying that Allah has created us and left us on our own. It does not fit at all. Number one, with the pure, rational, philosophical arguments. And number two, of course, verses of Holy Quran. Plenty of verses. You are not the one who do. Allah is the doer. You don't intend. Allah intends. Allah will accomplish Shayan Ghadir. He is the one who does. You name it. It's not one or two. I can read it and read it. So what you will say about those verses? You are saying that Allah has done his job and retired and gave you full freedom to do whatever you want to do on your own? No, that does not make sense. So the problem is, as I said, Hadith from Imam Musa Kajim alayhi salatu wassalam, that Asharites took away justice of Allah and Mu'tazilites took away Tawheed. So what is the solution? Middle path. Middle path is the solution. Neither compulsion nor absolute freedom. Here, I promise you, and it is here, his argument he starts by saying that first of all, that's in response to Asharites, that's in response to those who believe in compulsion. That, sorry, this opinion of you is against a very basic, obvious, natural finding of ourself. You don't need to read ayat of Quran for that. You don't need to know. There are certain things each person can find himself obvious. Maulana Rumi says, "Inke bithwanam on khanam ya on khanam khud dalil-e ikhtiyara faisanam." Maulana Rumi says that if I can think like that, I can do that, I must do that, or I must do that. I should do that, or I should do that. I should go this way, or I should go that way. This is itself the proof that I am free. So, by saying that we have no free will and we have no say over our actions, so denying a very basic, obvious finding of insan itself. You don't need to do any research. Just go back to yourself. Can you? I'm sitting here. I want to talk. I don't know what I mean. You are trying to say, no, Allah, stop. You are talking now. That's contradiction to a very basic fact which we find. Yes, so this is the answer to Jabriya, which is very simple. And of course, all those arguments are there. Because if there is no free will, then what about justice of Allah? If there is no free will, then what is the purpose of creation? If there is no free will, then what is the purpose of Anbiya? If there is no free will, then what is the purpose of, you know, what is the purpose of Anbiya? And if there is no free will, then what is the purpose of, you know, Shariat and commands and Anbiya? That's all those arguments are there. But this here establishes a vijdan, what we call it, what we find ourselves. You know, some people say, yeah, but sometimes we doubt. No, my brother, doubt itself is a proof of free will. If you can doubt, it means wrong. This is always, as I said, it's doubt, it means. What is doubt? 50-50, no? 50-50 is only possible when you can go this way or you can go that way. This middle path, which is path of Ahlul Bayt,
explain to us that we don't have to accept thinking of compulsion or determinism, neither we have to also fully accept free will or tafweez of Marcus Aurelius, both of them. We can combine both of them. How we can combine both of them? We can combine both of them in this manner.
Please listen carefully.
That for one action, there can be two actors. Please, I need your attention. Please, this is 2 minutes job, but dedicated job. For one action, there can be two actors. There can be two actors. But these two actors, or multiple actors, can have various possibilities. How they play their role. And that is what we want to discuss it. When we are talking about,
we will discuss a little bit later than Adan Kadamba, a little bit more in detail, just to conclude this point.
Our action, our choice, or our effectiveness, we're talking about effectiveness at the moment. Our effectiveness and Allah's effectiveness are not what we in terminology call it horizontal. In other words, they are not in competition with each other. They are not on one level. They are
what's called vertical, like that. Horizontal is like that, right? Vertical is like that. Correct? Horizontal, when two people are on equal level.
So you are saying, I am effective, Allah is also effective. That's shirk. But vertical means what? Means Allah is effective right on top. In the same line, bottom, I am also. Also effective. It is possible. It's not impossible. Therefore, brothers and sisters, listen carefully. We in the school of Ahlul Bayt, as taught by Ahlul Bayt, the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, have very strong belief in the law of cause and effect. Give me a chance. Let me read it from Allah Ta'ala quickly for you, that paragraph. That will help. Salawat Allah Muhammad wa Ali
Muhammad.
Allah Ta'ala, you know, he says that it is impossible for Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to effect, to actualize, to materialize, to actualize His will without system of cause and effects. System which again is His creation. Let's go back to that example of fire and heat. Who gives the heat? Allah gives heat. But how Allah gives this heat? By making fire effective in creation of heat. Are you with me or not? By creating,
by giving this effect of producing heat to fire. So fire is indeed the cause. And therefore, Allah Ta'ala said, it's impossible that Allah will actualize His will, His intention, His irada directly. No. Sunnatullah, the trend of Allah is this, that when He actualizes His will, He actualizes through His system. Through His system. Who brings baby into this world? Allah, of course. But does He just drop it from the sky like that? No. There's a whole system, there's a whole scenario which goes through from relationship of men and women, and then involvement and creation and meeting of sperm and all those levels until baby reaches to the point, he comes out of the womb and comes to this world. Who gave this baby birth? Allah, yes. How? Through the system. Are you with me or not? Therefore, he believes very strongly that it is not against at all the hate of Allah, but it is in line with the... Who does it? Allah does it. Who created the system? Allah, not somebody else. But it does not mean... We will discuss it a little bit when we divine, because we can enter to the same discussion from a different angle. Salaam ala Muhammad. Must we take a break quickly or then maybe? Yeah? No, then we'll go to the Qadha and Qadar. So let's take a 5 minutes break and then we will. But if there is a question meantime quickly on this part, these two discussions are very much mixed. So some discussion of free will and compulsion, but we'll enter from a different angle.